Morning, everybody. Lord's people, Lord's house on the Lord's day. So great to see everybody today. My name is John. If we haven't met, I'm one of the pastors here on staff. And isn't it amazing just to see the youthfulness on the stage leading us in worship today? Isn't that great? Yeah, I love it. I love it. Well, hey, I hope you guys had a great Christmas celebrating the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. And hopefully that was with friends and family and it wasn't too crazy, right? It wasn't too crazy. And this is crazy, though. This is like the final Sunday of 2019. Yeah, isn't that crazy? Yeah. Congratulations. You made it. You made it another year. We made it as a church this year. And I just really believe the word for me and Melissa is God's faithfulness this year. God has been incredibly faithful through all the seasons, through all the valleys this year, and we made it. We made it. Amen? Amen. Well, hey, there's a popular Christian woman who spoke for a women's conference several summers ago, and she told the story of her niece who had come home from preschool. And so the little girl, when she arrived home, her relatives began to ask her the normal questions, like, you know, how was your day? How was school? What did you learn? And after a few minutes, the little girl, the niece, said, yeah, it was all great, but Jesus wasn't there today. And the family kind of chuckled. They're like, oh, really? He wasn't there? And the little toddler got really serious. She goes, yeah, Jesus was not there today, but he's coming back tomorrow. And the family was like, okay, what is this? What does this mean? Well, the parents started investigating, and they found out the next day that it was actually the preacher that would come by and make it a point to stop by the preschool classroom and say hi to all the kids. And even though that he was really busy with work within the church and the school, he would always come say hi and always ask how the kids are doing. And so this toddler, this girl, just assumed, because of the big smile and the niceness of this pastor, that he was Jesus. That he was Jesus. Yeah. Great compliment, right? Well, let me ask you this morning. Are you so closely identified with Jesus that if you were missing from your office a few days, or students at school, or at the CrossFit gym maybe, would people see a difference that you weren't there? Would they say, you know what, something's missing. Christ isn't represented here today. Would that be true of you? Well, for every believer, our goal, God's will for us, plainly outlined in Scripture, is for us to grow in the likeness of Jesus Christ, to be conformed into the image of Jesus Christ. And so whether you're a new believer or whether you've been a seasoned believer for a long time, hopefully you and others can look at your life and say, you know what, I've seen growth in you. I've seen change in you. You're not the same person when I first met you. I see more of Jesus in you. I see his work and evident in your life. And so hopefully that's true of us. And so today, we're going to be looking at how we can continue to move forward in our growth and maturity in Christ. All right? So the title of this morning's message, if you're taking notes, is Keep Moving Forward. Keep moving forward. I'm going to have 4 points this morning. And so if you have a Bible, I hope you do, I invite you to turn to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. Does anybody love the book of Philippians? Very cool. It's one of my favorites. While you're turning there, I want to provide some context so we can just really understand what Paul's writing, okay? Paul, he's writing from prison. We believe that he was shackled, his wrists were shackled to another Roman guard as he's writing this letter to a people that he really loves, okay? He's writing to the Philippians, a church that Paul has visited a few times. And in chapter 1, he says that he really loves these people. It says that he brings them a lot of joy. He's thankful to the Lord for them, and he considers them partners in gospel work. Okay? And they've even sent Paul a gift to further his work, all right? And in chapter 3, Paul does this. He lists out all his spiritual accomplishments. He lists out all his work. I call this his spiritual resume, okay? He lists out what he thought would gain him favor and acceptance into heaven. What he thought that he needed to have before God so that he can enter into heaven, okay? But in verse 8, you might know this verse. It's one of the more popular ones in Philippians. He says this, but I count it all as loss. You know it, amazing, or rubbish, trash, compared to knowing Jesus. So Paul, he has this 180. He has this turn. Instead of gaining acceptance, trying to gain acceptance and earn salvation and merit it. He says, you know what? I'm just going to accept the free gift that Jesus is giving me. I'm going to accept the free gift accomplished by Jesus Christ. And this is what we call the great doctrine of our faith, salvation by works through faith. It's by faith that we are saved. It's not by what we do. We cannot earn the acceptance of God unless you've been completely perfect. Anybody in here completely perfect, never sinned? No, none of us. And so we receive it through his glove, through his grace, by faith. And then verses 9 through 11, Paul says, now that I've made this trade, my whole life is now dedicated to knowing Jesus and to pursue him and become like him until the day of glory. So with that context in mind this morning, let's look at verse 12, okay? Verse 12 in chapter 3 of Philippians. Anybody excited to get in God's word this morning? Amen. Amen. Let's go. Woo! Let's do it. All right, verse 12. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. All right. So what does Paul mean by obtain this? What does he mean that he hasn't obtained this? What is the this that Paul is referring to? Well, I'm glad you asked. I have it in my notes. Just happen to have it right here. He means spiritual perfection. That's what Paul means. He means spiritual perfection. He means to be completely without sin, to be completely conformed into the image of Christ. That's what he means. But Paul says, I'm not there yet. I haven't arrived. I'm nowhere close to that, okay? So my first point of four this morning and how we can move as individuals and together, move forward into Christian maturity and growth is admitting we haven't arrived. First point this morning, that we have not arrived. The truth is, no one has arrived. No one in this room, me, we have not arrived. There's only one person that's been perfect. And we all know who that is. Who is that? Say it together. Jesus. And everyone else? Not so much. Not so much. And part of maturing and growing as a Christ follower, everyone, is admitting that we haven't arrived. And it's also to be aware and cognizant of where we still sin and where we still fall short. It's being real with yourself. It's saying, you know what, here's where I'm weak. Here is some of my blind spots that someone has told me. It's taking an introspective look at yourself and being real and saying, I still sin. I'm still not there, but I want to change. I have that drive. I have that desire for God to work in me to be mature, to grow in the likeness of Jesus Christ. And this process of God working in us through the Holy Spirit, through one another, and through God's word, to be conformed to the image of Christ, it's a big word, you ready? It's called sanctification. Sanctification, big word in the Bible, big but important word for us to understand. Here's what sanctification is. It's a lifelong process in which believers are becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. That's what sanctification is, the process in which we're becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. Putting off sin, putting on Christ. This process, it's refining. And sometimes it doesn't feel good. I don't know about you, but I'm still not that place where I'm okay with someone pointing out my sin and me being like, you know what, you're right. I'm gonna accept that 100%. You know, like, there's still part of me that's like, ooh, that's painful. I don't like that. I don't like that I have these inconsistencies. I don't like that. Like with Paul in Romans 7, you know how he says, I do what I don't want to do, but I know what's right? I know it's like the battle between the flesh and the spirit. Like it's frustrating. Sanctification, it's a process that moves us away from patterns of sin into patterns of holiness and set apart living. That's sanctification. Now sanctification comes after another big word. You ready for it? Does anybody know? Starts with a J, ends with justification. Justification. Justification, right? Here's what justification is. It's the act of God declaring us righteous. God declaring us righteous, okay? Justification happens in a moment. Happens in a moment. It happens once, okay? It happened whenever, if you've trusted Christ fully for salvation, that moment, that's when God justified you, okay? It cannot be undone. You are sealed. You are saved. You cannot lose your salvation, okay? It happened in a single moment when you first trusted Christ, whether that was at Awana, possibly, or whether that was at a camp, maybe at the end or during a message. through a friend, or maybe you could have just been at home in God's word, and then that was it. You're like, I believe. I'm receiving the love, receiving Jesus as my Lord and Savior. That moment, you were justified. Now, justification. Justification is effortless to us. Effortless. We believe, we're saved, just like that. Sanctification, not so much. It's not effortless. It's hard work. And it's not a moment like justification. It's moments over a lifetime. Moments over a lifetime. And one of the main areas where God is refining us and working on us is through our relationships. How many guys would say that's true of me? Like, yeah, God is working on me through my relationships. Yes, yes. And because none of us have arrived, because none of us are perfect, we should be incredibly gracious to one another. We should be giving each other the benefit of doubt. We should, as best we can, as Proverbs 19 says, overlooking offenses. And if we can't overlook offenses, then God instructs us how we deal with those things. This should humble us. And I wholeheartedly believe that everybody in this room this morning would not say, you know what, Pastor John, I've arrived. I'm perfect. I've got this Christianity thing down. I don't think anybody would say that. But the way that we live, might as well be saying it. The way we treat each other, might as well have said, yeah, I've graduated. I'm on this varsity level of Christianity. You know what? That's me too. That's me too. I wish that I was better at treating people. I wish I was better at forgiving. And if you are, if you do have this belief, or you do act that way, God's word is just telling us that we're wrong. It shouldn't be that way. The fact that none of us have arrived, it shouldn't puff us up. It should humble us. It should humble us. None of us have arrived. What's some examples? Here's some examples. What about when you're confronted with sin? How do you take that? Do you get defensive? Do you make excuses? Well, if she didn't do this to me, then I wouldn't have reacted, right? Or do you blame shift? Man, I'm guilty of that one. Do you blame shift and put it on someone else? Do you listen to people when they come to you in a loving way? What about when someone wrongs you? Since we're all works in progress, since we all haven't arrived and we wrong people, I just believe that we should be patient with one another and more forgiving, because that's what Jesus calls us to do. Part of the sanctification process, church, is admitting that none of us have arrived and continually asking God to work in us. Asking God, God, I haven't arrived. Please continue to work in me. Because here's the truth. There's always going to be lessons that all of us are going to need to relearn and hear again, right? We haven't got everything down. We're going to need to be reminded truths in God's word. There's always going to be something new to discover in his word, something to be understood, something to be applied. And there's always going to be sin, plenty of sin for us to repent of. None of us have arrived, all right? Look back in your Bibles. Next, Paul says this at the end of verse 12. But I press on to make it my own, to make it my own. So the question that we should be asking when we come to here is this. If God's already saved me, if God's justified me, if I'm sealed and I can't lose my salvation, why should I strive to become perfect? Why should I strive to grow in maturity? If I'm never gonna attain perfection on this side of eternity, why should I strive? Why try if I'm never gonna attain? Well, Paul gives us the answer, and it's incredible. Look back in your Bible. He says, but I press on to make it my own. Here it is. Because Christ Jesus has made me his own. What a beautiful statement. Because Christ has made me his own. Those of us who are believers in here, man, isn't that a great comfort? Isn't that just a powerful verse? Does anybody need to hear that this morning? That you belong to Jesus Christ? That he called you and that you are his own? Maybe you're here this morning and you haven't made that decision to follow Jesus. I want to tell you this morning that it's available. You can belong to Jesus today. And it's free. It's not clean yourself up and then come to Jesus. It's come as you are. He accepts you as you are. And maybe this morning you need to hear that because you're going through some tough times in life. And you just need to be reminded of this amazing truth. You belong to Jesus. He has you. He's got you. And he's never going to let go. Amen? The heart of being a Christian means to belong to Jesus. That's what it means. It's not a set of rules or rituals. It means to belong to Jesus. And because we belong to Jesus, we should desire to become like him, to pursue maturity, to grow in our faith and walk with him. And we can't get that twisted. We can't get it backwards. It's not become to belong. It's belong then to become. We belong then we become. We can say it like this. I have it here on the screen. We move forward to live our lives up to the standards of what Jesus Christ modeled and what God declares us, righteous and holy. Because God has set us free, because God has declared us innocent, righteous through the work of Jesus Christ, we have the freedom and the will to become more like Jesus through his help and through one another's help. It's amazing. Praise God for that. All right. Second point, we move forward without looking back. We move forward without looking back. Look at verse 13. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. All right, this is how we know that Paul was a preacher and a pastor. He says but one thing, but then he lists two things. Right? Did anybody grow up in a church where like the pastor was like, you know what, in conclusion, then he like went another 30 minutes? Anybody grew up in that church? Or when the pastor goes, I have 3 points today, and there's like six, right? Right? I don't know if they teach math in at seminary, but I don't know. It's a thing, right? Here, Paul is telling his readers that he refuses to look back. He refuses to look back on his past because looking back would cause him to lose focus. It would cause him and it would halt his forward progression in his pursuit of Jesus Christ in growth and maturity, okay? So Paul, it's not explicitly in the text, but in the original language, Paul actually uses a sports analogy. Paul was a sports fan, isn't that cool? He used a sports fan, and one of his favorite analogies is running. He actually uses it a couple more times in his letters. In Acts 20, he uses it, verse 24, and then 2 Timothy 4, 6 through 7, he uses a running analogy again. He uses it to help others connect and identify that his pursuit of Jesus is like a race, okay? So Paul, he sees himself here running the race. He's running a race, and he sees the end goal. He sees the finish line. He sees the prize. And if he looks back, if he looks side to side or he gets distracted, he knows that he's going to lose focus and not be able to move forward, right? And I don't know if you know a lot about running, but in running, if you get distracted, if you don't stay forward, if you don't keep forward focus, and you're looking side to side, or you celebrate too early, okay, this could happen. Check out this video.
Take my word for it. There's a moral to this story.
Yeah, maybe next time wait that extra second before celebrating. A college track star learned the dangers of premature celebration. A runner from the University of Oregon thought he had the race locked up. Started waving, pumping up the crowd.
That can happen, all right? If you celebrate too early or you let up too early, you can lose the race, all right? Check out this next video. This guy has a lead, okay? This guy has a lead.
Watch this, folks. I mean, the guy had what?
Everything's going great.
At least. Look at this guy go.
He lets up.
This guy is beautiful.
And.
Look at this guy. The guy.
Oh!
Exactly.
I know we're just having fun, but the truth is, if we look back to our past, if we get sideways and we don't focus in, it can really cause us not to move forward. It could really halt our forward progression in Jesus Christ. So I have a few things that might have caused or maybe is causing you from moving forward. So three things. The first one is this: past failures. Past failures can definitely halt us from moving forward. Maybe you're here today and your past still haunts you. It keeps coming back up. The shame, the guilt, the embarrassment. And to be honest with you guys, I have those things in my life. And I can even remember, I don't know about you, you don't have to raise your hand, this is pretty deep, but I can remember like even the exact places and exactly what I did. And the enemy, he loves to bring those things back up. He loves to remind us of our past. He loves to make us feel shame. He loves to make us feel guilty for what we've done. And I wholeheartedly believe that Paul went through this struggle too. That's why he's saying, I refuse to look back. Let me ask you this. Do you think Paul forgot the faces and exact places of those he persecuted before he became a Christian? I think he forgot that. Do you think Paul easily forgot that he was part of the stoning of Stephen in Acts? That he basically approved of it? Do you think he forgot those things? I don't think so. Paul, like us, those things could cripple us. It could halt us from moving forward. But listen, Paul chose the cross. You know why? Because the cross changes everything. It changes everything because of the cross. You can leave your past behind you. Because of the cross, you've been given a new identity. Because of the cross, you and I are forgiven fully, forever, by Jesus Christ. You've been given a new identity. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says this, if anyone is a new creation, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. So if you're here this morning, if you're here this morning and you have shame and guilt, I have good news for you. The gospel can set you free today. Can set you free today for free. So what do you need to leave behind to move forward? What do you need to give up to the Lord? What do you need to lay before the cross to move forward? You're not your mistakes. You're not your past sins. You're a new creation. But also, secondly, something else can hinder us from moving forward is this, past achievements. Past achievements. These are past victories, big moments in your walk with Jesus Christ. Maybe it was camp, a revival, whatever it is. Listen, great milestones, great testimonies, great things that the Lord did in your midst. We're not minimizing or saying that it's not important, but we cannot lose sight of what's ahead of us. We can't just go back for the sake of nostalgia. We just can't go back and live in those days or say, you know what, the good old days are behind us. You know, I don't know what's... No, the Lord has more for you to do. The Lord has more for us to do as a church, as an individual. We give thanks for the Lord for those things. We celebrate and worship the Lord for those things. We reload and we press on. We move forward. There was a lady at our last church, upper 80s, and she was part of all these huge Billy Graham crusades, revival. So, I mean, she saw just, you know, thousands of people come to the Lord, amazing things throughout her life. She was lifetime Christian, upper 80s, and she always come to us and say, can I serve? Can I still get involved? And we'd be like, yes. Like, we're not going to say no. And one time I asked her, I said, hey, I was trying not to make her feel old. I was, you know, I said, why do you still serve? Like, what keeps you going? What gives you energy? You know, you've seen all these amazing things. What keeps you going? And she goes, well, do I look dead? I said, no. I said, well, has Jesus come back? I said, no. Well, I hope not, because we're still here, you know. And she said, are there still unbelievers in this world? I said, yeah. She goes, well, I'm not done yet. There's still more kingdom work to do. Don't ever ask me that question again. I'm like, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. All right, what do you want to do? Any service opportunity, you got it, right? And number three is life circumstances, past life circumstances. You know, Paul, he could have dwelt on his past sufferings. He had plenty of them, and beatings, shipwrecks, imprisonments, and rejection. Paul could have said this, you know what? Every time I preach the gospel, every time I preach, it's good news for those people, but I seem to get bad news. I get beat. I get thrown in prison. I get rejected. Something always bad happens to me. You know what? Every time I take a missionary journey, every time I go to a new place, I get deserted. My own people hate me. They want to kill me. I get thrown in prison. And even fellow missionaries that were partners with me, they leave me. Paul could have had that attitude, and these things could have got him down. But you know what? He kept going because he had joy. He kept going. And listen, maybe you're here today with some real past life circumstances. And I'm not just saying 20, 30 years ago. Like, the past could be yesterday. Like, that's history. Even this week, a month or 5 months ago. And it's crippled you. It's halted you from moving forward. Maybe it's led to mistrust, depression, weariness, anxiety. But I want to encourage you here this morning that you belong to God, you belong to Jesus. That's what it means to be a Christian, right? And that I encourage you to continue to trust God and put support around you. And in time, you'll be able to move forward. You'll be able to move forward. God is in the business of redeeming and healing us. Amen? Well, I don't know if you know too much about the sport of running, but runners, they're not left to their own. They have coaches. They have teammates, especially in competition. They don't have to guess. They don't have to look back to see what's behind them. No, they have a coach that's telling them their mile splits. They have a coach telling them, hey, you're 5 minutes away from the lead pack. Like, it's time to turn it on right now, right? Or, hey, 10 seconds behind you is the rest of everybody. It's time to turn it on, right? You have coaches. They're not left to their own. And I just want to encourage everybody in here that, listen, we're not left alone in this journey with Jesus Christ. We have something better than a coach. We have something better than a teammate. We have an older brother. We have a trustworthy friend, a great high priest named Jesus, who has gone before us, who knows what's before us, who understands everything that we will go through, who has been tempted in every way that we will be tempted, and he completely sympathizes with us. We don't need to let the past keep us. We only need to look forward to keeping our eyes on the author and perfecter of our faith. Let's move forward. Amen? Next, we move forward with a holy discontentment. We move forward with a holy discontentment. I'm just gonna be honest with you. I stole that phrase from another pastor. I couldn't think of anything better. I loved it. Holy discontentment. Look at verse 13 and 14. Brothers, I do not consider that I've made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Jesus Christ. I don't know if you caught this, but Paul, do you feel his drive? Do you feel the persistence in his voice? Do you feel the fight in his words? He says, but I press on. I strain towards and forwards the goal. I press towards the goal. It's this attitude of, I'll do whatever it takes to move the ball down the field. Paul is not done. And listen, Paul, of anybody that's ever lived as a Christian, he could have let up a little bit. He could have. He could have had that attitude. He could have said, you know what? I've been a Christian for 30 plus years. Do I really need to do anything else? I mean, I planted churches throughout the whole known world. I've been a pretty amazing missionary. I've seen miracles. Jesus, spoke to me. I'm currently writing most of the New Testament right now. That's going to be inspired. If anybody could have let up, it would have been Paul. It could have been Paul. He could have said, you know what? I'm on the back nine of my life. Done enough. It's time for someone else to do it. I'm done. Done enough. I'm sealed. Been justified. You know, I'm saved. I'm good. No, Paul's not done yet. He still has drive. Paul has a holy discontentment. He's not content with where he is today, and neither should we. And here's what a holy discontentment could look like. A holy discontentment could say, you know what? Like Paul, I haven't arrived. I haven't fully matured. I still have gaps. I still have blind spots in my life. I need community. I need others to love me. And for me to extend that to them too, I need accountability. That's holy discontentment. It could also look like this. You know what? My prayer life, it's not where I want it to be. Either I'm not praying, or I want to pray more boldly and more fervently and frequently. I'm not satisfied with where I am. And when it comes to worship, yes, I've tasted and I have seen that the Lord is good, but I'm not content with my level of worship. I want it to raise because God is worthy. He's worthy of my praise. And I want to magnify him more and more in my life. What about your time in the Word? You know what? I'm not content with where I am today in God's Word. I want to know the God of the Bible. God's Word is more precious than gold and silver. And I want that to be true of my life more and more. I want to memorize Scripture. I want to hide it in my heart. I want it to guide and direct me. That's what a discontent, holy life could look like. Or, you know what? God's called me to be the spiritual leader in my household. You know what? I've been lazy. Or, you know what? I'm doing it, but I'm not content with where I am today. I want to keep pressing into Jesus. I want to keep learning and growing. That's what it could look like. It's a refusal, church, to be complacent, to settle. Complacent. Ugh. I just hate that word. It's nasty coming out of my mouth. Complacent. I looked it up, complacency, in the dictionary. It says this. It's a feeling of smug or uncritical satisfaction with oneself or one's achievements. It's looking at your life and saying, you know what? I've done enough. I'm good. I've achieved enough. I'm good with just, it's right here. Not too much, not too little, but, you know, right here. Complacency. It's one of the enemy's tactics to keep us from moving forward. But listen, we can choose today not to have that attitude. We can choose, you can choose today, put a stake in the ground and say, you know what? Settling, not an option for me, not an option for my family, not an option for our church. We can refuse to be complacent. We can choose as a campus and as a church not to be that stat where 85% of ministry is done by 15% of the church. We can refuse that, and we can serve, and we give of our lives. We could choose to be a church and a campus that doesn't just consume everything, but we live it out in our city, in our schools, in our neighborhoods, in our offices, because we have a huge mission before us. We have also a big God that can do more than we could ever dream and imagine. As Ephesians 3 says, God has equipped us for everything to do his good work. So let me ask you this morning, church. Let me ask you as an individual, and only you know this. Have you developed a holy discontentment in your walk with Jesus Christ? Have you? Are you discontent with where you are today? Do you want to be like Paul and press on? And move forward towards the goal. Man, I hope you are. I hope you are. Finally, my last point. Finally, we move forward together. We move forward together. Look at verse 15. Let those of us who are mature think this way, and if in any of you think otherwise, God will reveal it that also to you. I love Paul. Here's what Paul's basically saying. He's saying, I'm right. And if you think I'm wrong, God's going to show you that you're wrong. Isn't that crazy? Isn't that funny? Then he says in verse 16, only let us hold true to what we have attained. Verse 17, this is our verse. Brothers, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. Now, Paul's not being arrogant, okay? He's saying, hey, join me in my pursuit of Jesus Christ. But let's keep a watch on one another. Let's make sure that we all are going towards the same goal. Let's make sure that we take care of one another. Paul is saying this, find people who are moving in the same direction as you are, forward towards Jesus Christ. Paul says, do life with them, hang out with them, learn from them, speak wisdom and truth and love in them. And if you see someone in sin, restore them gently, go to them and have a tough conversation. But in love, it also can look like this. If you have a sin that you want breakthrough in, you don't have to do it alone. In fact, you can't do it alone. Maybe find someone that has a similar struggle or has struggled with that and ask and learn from them. And if you've been a seasoned Christian for a while or a lifelong Christian, we have that responsibility to raise up this next generation. I don't know if you know this, but it's not given that this next generation is just going to somehow accept Jesus Christ without any work. It's not just going to happen. We have to be intentional. I think it's so great that we had so many students and young adults on the stage this morning. That should be encouraging to us. That should be amazing to us. And I hope that we're always that campus that cares for our kids and our students, because they're the next church leaders of our church. If we don't intentionally disciple and invest in them, then there's not going to be another church. We won't continue. Paul says, not only do we move individually forward in maturity, but we have the Christian responsibility of helping others make to the finish line too. It's this whole idea that I need you, but also you need me. We need each other. We're not each other's competition. We're not rivals. Same team, same jersey, headed towards the same goal. Amen? Well, 10 years ago, my good friend and mentor, Sean, he was in our wedding together, standing on the stage. Huge influence in my life. 10 years ago, he was a big cycler, like to ride bikes, and he turned 30 10 years ago, and he came up to me, and I just got into cycling, like as in like riding 5-10 miles. He comes up to me, he says, "Hey, 20 of us are going to do this century ride. You want to come?" I'm like, "Yeah, sure." You know, I was just like, "Whatever, sure, I'll ride my bike." I went home, and I looked up what a century ride was, and it's a 100-mile ride. So I'm like, he's kidding. There's no way. 100 miles? He's kidding. Well, he wasn't. So, like, we get to Saturday morning at 5 a.m. We meet, you know, at his house, and everybody's jazzed up, you know. They're on their tights, you know, and their super aerodynamic bikes. And I just kind of came in like gym shorts, you know. I was like, we're not going to do it 100 miles. They're like, are you excited for 100 miles? I'm like, actually, no. I thought you were kidding, you know. And so we start riding, and about mile 40, I said, "Hey guys, I'm done." Truthfully, I yelled at them because they were miles ahead. I'm like, "I'm done. I'm tapping out. I'm done. Like, my legs, can't feel them. They're cramping, you know? I'm done. And even my eyes, I don't know why they hurt, but they're cramping too, you know? Like, my whole body, I'm done. I'm done." And they're like, "But it's Sean's 30th birthday." I'm like, "Oh my gosh, you really gonna say that? Okay." They're like, "Aren't you having so much fun? This is so great. It's so cool to exercise." I'm like, "No, it's not. No, I'm hurting." So they convinced me to continue. Before we continued, after mile 40, I had to lay like on the side of the road, you know, all sprawled out. And they're like, "Do you want some water?" I'm like, "Yes." "Do you want some energy?" "Yeah, I need that. You know, like, I'll take whatever." And so they fueled me on up. And it turns out we keep going. We get to mile 80, and then like five more of them start cramping because we're at mile 80, you know. And so like we finish. Okay, I'm standing. We finished 10 years ago, and you know it was awesome. I told Sean, if you ever have another birthday party and it involves bicycling, I'm not coming. If it's like sitting on the couch eating pizza, watching a game, in. Okay, not bicycling, right? And so we get done, we finish, and we're all like excited and hurting. And I look back at everybody, I said, "Hey guys, thank you. Man, you pulled me, you got me through, we finished. It wasn't pretty, we actually finished 2 hours later than what we estimated." And they said this, I'll never forget, they said, yeah, no problem. No problem, John. No problem at all. You did great, you finished. You finished, you made it to finish line." And they said this, "We were all in this together." And they said, "There was no way that we were going to leave you behind. There was no way that we were going to leave you behind." And that's the picture that Paul is giving us in verse 17. Join him in imitating and growing in maturity and growth in Jesus Christ. Yes, as individuals, but also let's help one another. Because we're in this all together. It's not just me, but it's us. It's we. Amen? Well, as we close, that doesn't mean 25 more minutes of a sermon. Here's what I want you to do. If you have a pen, or if you were taking notes this morning, or I don't know, maybe you want to use your device, Here's what I want us to do. I want us to write individually one goal, one spiritual goal, and how you can grow and mature in your walk with Jesus Christ. What's one goal that you have? Maybe it's time to join a small group and do life with other believers so that you can find strength and unity and accountability. Maybe it's serving. Maybe it's serving here in our church. And listen, we don't want you to serve just because there's a need. We want you to serve ultimately because you're serving Jesus Christ, and that's going to push you more into spiritual maturity. And God calls you to do it. But what about worship, like we were talking about earlier? Maybe scripture memorization. Or maybe one spiritual goal you have this year is, you know what? I'm going to step out in faith and tell someone about Jesus this year. Haven't done it ever or in a long time, but this year, my neighbors, they can pick the time and place. They're going to know about my Lord Jesus Christ and the hope and joy that I have. Maybe it's getting in the Word more. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's giving. I encourage you to write that down. We all have, maybe you have fitness goals. Maybe you have financial goals or family goals, career goals. And all those things are great. But Paul says in 1 Timothy 4, but godliness is of more value. Godliness and training is of more value. So what's your goal or goals, not just 2020, but today? You don't have to wait till Tuesday. You can get started today. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you for your guidance and your direction. God, thank you for this church. This is not my church. It's no one's church. It's Jesus' church. It's yours. And God, we know that we have a big mission ahead of us. And that mission is going to be accomplished through your work in us. So God, I pray that we would collectively together strive into Christian maturity, that we continue to grow in godliness, and that we would help one another make it to the finish line, whenever that is. And Jesus, we eagerly await your second coming. We celebrated your humble coming. But Father, your next coming, people are gonna know. People are gonna know. And so God, we just rely on you and trust you to help us make that message known. We love you so much. And God, the goals that we're writing down or that we have in our hearts, we know that only you can help us make those realities. So God, we just ask you to continue to work in this. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.